Hey there. So the podcast is currently on an extended hiatus so that I can write my next book and work on some other exciting projects. But while we're away, I hope you'll enjoy this fan favorite episode from the archives. If you want brand new content to help you make peace with food and heal from diet culture, come sign up for my free weekly newsletter at christyharrison.com/newsletter, where I answer a weekly listener question. And as always, if you join my intuitive eating fundamentals course at christyharrison.com/course, you get access to our exclusive monthly Q&A podcast where I answer all your new questions. Just go to christyharrison.com/newsletter and christyharrison.com/course to sign up, or click the links in the episode description. Welcome to Food Psych, a podcast about intuitive eating, health at every size, body liberation, and taking down diet culture. I'm your host, Christy Harrison, and I'm an anti-diet registered dietitian, certified intuitive eating counselor, and author of the book Anti-Diet: Reclaim Your Time, Money, Well-being, and Happiness Through Intuitive Eating, which is available wherever books are sold. Join me here every week as I interview interesting people from all different backgrounds about their paths toward peace with food and their bodies. And by the way, on this show, we bleep out diet culture stuff like weight and calorie numbers, but we don't censor swear words or other adult language, so listener discretion is advised. Hey there, welcome to episode 218 of Food Psych. I'm your host, Christy Harrison, and today I'm talking with eating disorder therapist Stephanie Zone for the fourth in our four-part series about how diet culture is a life thief, all about how diet culture steals our happiness and our joy. Stephanie and I also discuss the physical and emotional effects of restriction and self-blame, why dieting and disordered eating are like being in an abusive relationship, the problem with the narrative that trauma, quote unquote, causes larger body size, and so much more. I cannot wait to share this conversation with you in just a moment. It is such a good one. But first, I'll answer this week's listener question, which is from a listener named Jackie, who writes, "Hi, Christy. First, I wanted to say thank you for the positive work you do for our society and the message you're trying to convey. I feel as though I'm one of your younger listeners. I just turned 23 in the beginning of October, but I've been listening to your podcast since I was 21. My question comes in the form of an internal conflict. I was in a larger body for all of high school and lost weight after high school on a particular diet that bills itself as quote unquote medically supervised. This weight loss, temporary weight loss, I might add, changed my interests and career path to nutrition and food science. I received my bachelor's degree, but I'm currently working on my PhD in dietetics. The shocking part, sarcasm, is that I have gained most of my weight back, which I know is the scenario in most cases of dieting. I know you went to school for nutrition, and I wanted advice. I'm internally struggling because I'm now finding myself not wanting to be a part of the diet culture that the nutrition field has become. But I'm so passionate about food and helping others, but not in the traditional sense like diet culture wants us to follow. For a young nutritionist and dietetics major like me, what do you recommend? I don't want to change my major because I love learning about nutrition and food science, but I hate the concept that our culture wants me to tell people that you're not enough if you have a larger body, or that you should eliminate certain foods and that's beneficial when I don't believe that. I'm also seeing a pattern that most of my peers, including myself, have all sorts of eating disorders and eating trauma, and that's not a community I want to be a part of. How did you overcome that? Thanks so much." So thanks, Jackie, for that great question. And before I answer, just my standard disclaimer that these answers and this podcast in general are for informational and educational purposes only and are not a substitute for individual medical or mental health advice. So first of all, I just want to send you so much empathy and compassion and support for having to go through this. I know from experience how difficult school for nutrition and dietetics can be and how it can be such a diet culture minefield. And that is doubly true when you're someone in a larger body, because the field of dietetics on the whole is really fat phobic still, which I talked about recently in episode 213 with Christina Johnson and episode 214 with Kimmy Singh. They're just a few of the many, many, many people who have gone through fat phobic experiences in training to be dietitians. So you're not alone. And so now getting to your question, I just want to throw out a couple of things to consider in answer to this question. One is my view as an activist and as someone who's trying to change our culture. And the other is my opinion as a helping professional who wants to help you make the best self-care decision for yourself. So as an activist and a culture maker, to borrow a phrase from Kelly Deals, I really want to encourage you to stick with it because our field needs people like you. You know, we need more dietitians in larger bodies and dietitians of color and disabled dietitians and trans dietitians and all other diverse identities of dietitians, because that is so important for helping our field overcome its legacy of diet culture and white supremacy and oppression in general. So the more dietitians there are who don't look like that stereotypical, you know, thin, white, able-bodied, cisgender woman, hello, like me, right? More dietitians out there who don't look like me is better, because that helps us dismantle diet culture. That helps us smash the status quo in dietetics, which includes dismantling diet culture within the profession, as well as all other forms of oppression within the profession. So it's really, really important to have more dietitians out there who are people like you, right? Who ask the question, like people who are in larger bodies and people who already get it in terms of health at every size and disordered eating. Because if you already understand this work, like you've already been listening to my podcast for a couple of years, when you're going into the field, you're going to be so much more equipped to help move the needle, to help push things in a pro health at every size and intuitive eating and fat positive direction. And you can absolutely have a fulfilling, wonderful career as an anti-diet dietitian, like I and so many of my guests on this show have ended up doing, you know, even in a larger body, which I know can be harder because of the weight stigma you face in this profession. Being a dietitian in a larger body is objectively more difficult, I would say, than being a dietitian in a smaller body. And you can still blaze your own trail. You can still create your own practice and work in this anti-diet space and have lots of people coming to you, like a lot of larger body dietitians I know, because it helps people to feel seen and feel safe if they can work with someone who looks like them or who they know is going to understand, as opposed to the stereotypical thin, white, able-bodied, cisgender female dietitian who, I mean, I've experienced this myself in my work. People have a hard time trusting me sometimes at first because I look like the people who've oppressed them. I look like the people who've made fun of them or who've stigmatize them for their weight or who've told them to lose weight and shame them. And so, of course, it can be difficult to open up to and trust a dietitian who is someone like me. So I think we need all of, you know, not that everybody's going to have a hard time trusting me. And I think another aspect of thin privilege is that people will come in my door and sort of assume that I know what I'm doing or talking about because of the way I look, which is not true, right? It doesn't say anything more about my education or credentials or experience that, you know, my body is the size it is as it does about anyone else who's in a larger body, right? Body size doesn't have anything to do with our knowledge or dedication to our work or skill level or anything like that. That's diet culture thinking that makes us think that body size is a sign of all those things. So I do want to highlight that it can be harder to be a dietitian in a larger body and to say that we need more dietitians in larger bodies to help make it more normalized, to help destigmatize it, to help move the needle on our profession as a whole and the culture as a whole. And so, you know, from that perspective, I really think our field needs you and I would love to welcome you in. But also this other perspective, right, is that you need to think about your own self-care, which is so important. And if your studies are making your disordered eating worse and are interfering with your ability to care for yourself and to truly heal your relationship with food and your body, then that's really a problem. So it sounds like you really do love your studies in some ways. You really love studying nutrition and food science. And I think that's awesome. And there is so much interesting stuff to be studied in this field. And there are some great uses for that information when you come out, when you go into the anti-diet field, right? It's actually, I would say, anti-diet myth busting and debunking of nutrition myths is a great use of nutrition information. So it sounds like you really love that stuff. It sounds like you really love the study of it, which is awesome. But that in some ways, your studies might be triggering to you too, especially in terms of the community you find yourself surrounded with. And by that, I mean the community of other students that are studying with you. So I think this is a matter of really listening to your intuition and trying to get clear on what that's telling you and trust what it's telling you. So if it feels important to you to finish your degree and go into the dietetics field to help dismantle diet culture from the inside out and to help bring more diversity and more visibility to larger bodies in this field, then we anti-diet dietitians would love to have you join us. I know I would welcome you in with open arms. I know that my colleagues would too. But if the triggering of studying nutrition and dietetics is just too much, if the community of fellow students is just too problematic and you find yourself not able to heal from diet culture and disordered eating in that milieu, then trust that and take care of yourself. Take care of that voice, that intuition that's maybe telling you this isn't good for your recovery. And so I'm not saying that it's not good for your recovery. I'm saying that, you know, it's something you need to look at within yourself, because only you truly know the answer as to whether, you know, this is going to be supportive of your self-care or not. But I think it's a really valuable question to ask yourself and maybe keep asking yourself until something bubbles up, until you do feel a strong sense of knowing. You are absolutely allowed to change careers and to switch into a career that is more supportive of your recovery if you, you know, realize that this one is not, because you deserve to be free. You deserve to be healed and to have a peaceful relationship with food and to have your studies and your eventual job support that, you know, support you in having that peaceful relationship with food. I also want to say, when we're talking about switching careers, that I know there are economic issues that can come into play when you think about that, right? So it's not always that easy. And actually, in my book, I open up about my own massive graduate school debt from switching careers into the nutrition and dietetics field. So I know how economically problematic it can be to switch careers. But just remember that your well-being is so important, and that there are creative ways to switch your studies or switch careers if that's really what's needed in order to heal your relationship with food and your body so that you can be truly free. So I hope that helps you just think through some of these questions. I know this is not really a cut and dry answer. This is more of like a set of questions to ask yourself and ideas to think about and ponder. And, you know, I really can't make the decision for you. I think it's something that needs to come from your own intuition and your own self-reflection. But I hope this was helpful in just guiding you to think through some of these questions. And just know that whatever you choose, whatever path you end up taking, whether you stay or whether you switch careers, you are valuable, you are worth it, you are worth recovery, and you deserve to have a career and a field that supports you in your recovery and in your healing. And we would also welcome you in the anti-diet space if that's what you choose. So thanks again for that question. And if you want to submit your own question for a chance to have it answered on an upcoming episode, go to christyharrison.com/questions. That's christyharrison.com/questions. And then if you want to get my answers a lot more quickly, you can come join my online course, Intuitive Eating Fundamentals, where I do an exclusive monthly Q&A for participants. And I have all kinds of other amazing resources and content as well to help you make peace with food and free up your time for the things that really matter. And right now, for just a little over one more week, if you're listening to this the day it comes out, you can get a special deal on this course, on the Intuitive Eating Fundamentals course, when you pre-order my book, Anti-Diet. So to learn more about that special deal and claim yours today, go to christyharrison.com/bookbonus. That's christyharrison.com/bookbonus. Or you can just go to christyharrison.com/book, and that will take you to the bonus page as well. And then if you want to read all about my online course and how it can help you break free from diet culture and reclaim your life for bigger and better things, go to christyharrison.com/course. That's christyharrison.com/course. This episode of Food Psych is brought to you by FareDrop. Did you know that when you fly, almost everyone on the plane has paid a different price for their ticket? I'm actually sure you did know that if you're someone in a larger body who has to pay for two seats on the plane, because that is just one of many ways that diet culture and weight stigma show up in the world and make things harder for people in larger bodies. But it's also true that everyone on the plane, no matter their size, pays wildly different prices, and there's really no rhyme or reason to flight prices a lot of the time. That is where FareDrop can help. FareDrop is a service that monitors constantly changing flight prices for thousands of date and route combinations to find hidden deals before they disappear. With FareDrop, you can fly around the world for up to 80% off. Recently, FareDrop notified their members of a round-trip flight to London for only $180, which is an incredible deal. When you sign up for FareDrop, you can set your local airport and desired destinations and months so that you only get amazing deals that really work for you. And now if you sign up at faredrop.com/foodpsych, you can get 2 months of free deals. That's faredrop.com/foodpsych, foodpsych, for 2 months of potentially life-changing flight deals. And now, without any further ado, let's go talk to Stephanie Zohn. So tell me about your relationship with food growing up.
My relationship with food growing up was all diet culture. That was the only thing I knew that existed. And in fact, one of my earliest memories is sitting on my parents' bed, and my dad was looking in the mirror and he's saying, "I'm fat, I'm fat." And he's kind of spitting the words out. And I said, "No, Daddy, you're not fat." And the reason I remember this so vividly is because I was lying. I actually had no idea what the word fat meant. I didn't know it was connected with body shape or size. I had no idea it was anything about food or about eating. I just knew my dad was upset. And when I think about it now, I think, man, like, what a people pleaser, you know, like from the get-go, what was wrong with me? But, you know, then on the other hand, as a psychologist, I know that for a really small child, your survival is based on the adults being well enough to take care of you. And I think it was a survival strategy to try to calm my dad down because he was so upset. But, you know, I think diet culture probably was around from when I was conceived. You know, I was born in 1967, and in the 60s and 70s, they told pregnant people to gain between and pounds when they were pregnant.
Oh my God.
I know. And so I am sure, you know, my mother, following doctor's orders, was restricting her eating during her entire pregnancy.
Yeah, of course. Like, it's such a little amount of weight. It's not sustainable in a pregnancy.
No, not at all. And it's not individualized. And so pretty quickly in my life, it became about me and my body. I was fat as a kid and I got teased a lot. And I'm a really sensitive person. And so I would cry, I'd get upset. It made me really a target for teasing. And when I would go to adults for, you know, hoping to get defended in some way, they would say some variation of, "Kids are mean, just ignore it." And it really sent the message to me that the teasing was my fault. I had definitely gotten the message it was my fault, because in some way I was supposed to be able to control my body, even if I was only 6 years old. But also because I kept reacting, because I just couldn't be cool about it, or I just couldn't ignore it. And I'm just, like, temperamentally as a person, even now, I don't think I could ignore that kind of, I mean, at the time they called it teasing. I think now they'd probably call it bullying.
Yeah. And that instruction of just ignore it is so dismissive of, like, the emotional experience that happens when you get bullied.
Yeah, it really, really was. And so, I mean, that was pretty much my experience throughout elementary school. And I would spend a lot of time when I was a kid looking in the mirror and trying to figure out what was wrong with me. And the thing was, I could never see it. always thought I looked okay. And I even thought I was beautiful. And I had this ongoing fantasy that a new kid would come to school and this new kid would be so like undeniably cool that everybody would like them. And this kid would choose me as their special person. And when I was really little, like first, second, third grade, this new kid was a girl. But as I got a little older, like fourth, fifth, sixth grade, this new person was a boy. So there was also kind of like a romance component to my fantasy. But what would happen is because this new person liked me, all of a sudden everybody else would see me differently. And they would kind of think, oh, Stephanie's own, like, you know, we've been missing out. She's cool. The thing that strikes me now as so powerful about this fantasy is I didn't have to change. It wasn't like one of those transformation movies where it's like the kid like loses weight and like learns how to feather their hair and wear cool clothes and comes back to school looking good. I looked exactly the same. I was the same person. And it was just that people could see me through a different lens.
That's like such a self-compassionate fantasy, right? And such a like aware fantasy of the fact that this was a social injustice being perpetuated on you, that it wasn't anything to do with you. It was just that people couldn't see you accurately.
You know, I've never thought about it as a social injustice. I love seeing it through that lens. So thank you.
Yeah. I mean, it really, you know, I think any sort of bullying and shaming based on weight or anything else, you know, about a kid that is part of their identity, even something they quote unquote could change, like their haircut or something like that, you know, bullying kids for their appearance in any way or for, I got bullied for like the car my parents drove or like, you know, socioeconomic type stuff, which was weird because I never wanted for anything. And yet we were sort of like the poor people in the suburban town where we moved. And so, you know, I think those kinds of things where it is out of your control to some extent, or it's something that you don't even recognize in yourself. And suddenly someone else is pointing to you and saying like, ew, you're bad for this quality that you have is just, it's a form of trauma and it's a form of really social injustice that, you know, nobody should be stigmatized like that for things that are just a part of who they are or a part of whatever expression they are doing in the world at that moment.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I also, when I think about it, I think, man, like what a plucky kid I was going to school every single day, you know, just kind of hopeful that things would be better.
Yeah, not stepping out and like faking illness or trying to, or yeah, skipping school or something. Like you kept going, you kept showing up.
Yeah, yeah.
When kids would tease you like that, how did you sort of get that pluck, I guess? Because it sounds like your parents didn't really have a good solution in terms of how to frame it for yourself. So where do you think that framing of it as, you know, locating the problem outside yourself came from?
You know, that's a really good question too. I'm not sure. I read a lot as a kid and that gave me like a whole different world to go into. And I think it even started to give me a sense of another culture, of counterculture. And that helped a lot, that there was a world outside of, you know, my little suburban Los Angeles community. And actually, one of the things I read that was really pivotal for me, I love to read everything and I would read the newspaper. And when I was 10, there was the 10th anniversary of Woodstock, which I had never heard of before. And there were pictures and they talked about this, you know, like music and hippies. And for some reason, I loved that whole idea. Like I was completely obsessed with it. And so I started to read like these biographies of rock stars like Janis Joplin and Jim Morrison. And there's this idea of like, it planted the seed of counterculture. And so even though like on the outside, I look like a, you know, kind of like trying to fit in normal suburban kid, on the inside, I was like, you know, like an inner hippie.
That makes total sense.
When I told my husband this, you know, we live in Berkeley now. He said the same. He's like, oh yeah. Totally get that.
It makes total sense. Yeah. And I feel like having that awareness of a counterculture in general is so like protective and healing for so many people, being aware that things are different outside of this little bubble that you might live in.
Mm-hmm. And that counterculture, it led me to reading about feminism. So it was like hippies and then rock stars and then feminism and then, you know.
Right. And that, I mean, you know, is such a huge protective factor, I think, for a lot of people. Even if it doesn't protect you from practicing diet culture in your own life, it can still protect you in terms of not falling as far into it or helping you come out of it when you actually are ready to turn things around.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. It helped shape my values and recognize that my values weren't the values that were all around me. And it gave me kind of a guiding light. It gave me a direction to go in. And so, you know, the idea of women being more than their bodies, there's a quote, I think it's Elizabeth Cady Stanton, I think, from like 1870, where she encourages girls to think of themselves not as adjectives, but as nouns. You know, so it's, you know, thinking of myself as not just what I was on the outside, as being more than that.
Right. That's huge. Like the subject of your own story as opposed to an object.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
And so what was your relationship with food like then as you were being bullied and then discovering the counterculture and discovering feminism? Did that change how you related to food? Did you ever sort of fall into diet culture and dieting yourself at that point? Or?
Yeah, well, in my house, it was just all diet culture. So we never had any of those fun foods like, you know, the cereals that were on the TV commercials or things like that. So I really desired those things a lot. And when there would be a party or an event or something, I mean, something my parents did that was really, really good is they did not send me to birthday parties with my own little baggie of diet food, which I have heard, you've probably heard it too.
Yeah.
I've heard that from so many people and it's so traumatizing. So I could go to parties and eat the, you know, pizza and cake and whatever. But because I didn't have it at home, it was really exciting to me and I really, really wanted it. And so that fed into this idea that I was insatiable and that being fat was my fault. And I was uncontrollable around food because of that kind of deprivation. So I did internalize the sense that it was, you know, that I had a problem. The problem was me. I remember, you know, sitting next to like my friends at a birthday party and they'd be kind of like picking at their cupcake and saying, oh, I don't even like chocolate. Or, and I would have like eaten mine as fast as possible and basically could have eaten all of theirs too. And I, you know, there was no sense of like, oh, if you're not deprived of these things, then it's not going to be so exciting. So I thought it really was my problem. And it was starting around, it wasn't middle school, it was junior high. So starting the beginning of junior high, I did start to engage in like intentional weight loss strategies that were just really fucked up and I wouldn't recommend. And I also did all of the transformational stuff. I became really vigilant about what I looked like. Like I have kind of crazy curly hair. And if you have curly hair and you grew up in a straight haired family, you know, it just makes your hair worse. So I learned how to blow dry my hair and what to wear. And I really internalized like that sense that I was okay. I kind of lost it in that vigilance. Like I felt like I had to see anything that was wrong with me before anybody else did. So during those years, that was really the years where I did internalize diet culture.
I feel like that is such an age when that happens, right? That sort of vigilance is pushed on us. And I don't know if you got any of that information from like magazines and media or friends, but I feel like it's just such a part of the culture of adolescence when you're assigned female at birth and identify as female that you like get wrapped up in the hair and the makeup and the changing of the appearance. I remember also I have naturally very thick wavy hair and grew up in the 80s and 90s and like, you know, the 90s when I was coming of age and high school and stuff was like, and well, junior high and high school was very straight hair, like the sort of heroin chic look, right? Like straight hair, almost non-existent eyebrows. And I have like very thick eyebrows and a lot of hair. And I was just constantly trying to like mash down and pluck out the hair that was, you know, supposedly wrong. And I very much identify with that feeling too, of just kind of losing your sense of okayness and starting to feel like I need to look for every possible flaw so that no one else can see it. Because if they see it, they're going to make fun of me and I'm going to feel shame. So let me like shame myself first, basically preemptive self-shaming so that I don't end up having to experience shame at the hands of other people.
Yeah, that was exactly what it was.
It feels like protection, but it's actually internalized shame. It's actually pain and trauma, but we think of it as protective.
Yeah. Yeah. And that kind of like self-monitoring, it's so joy sucking, you know, because it's like you can never just be free and silly and be yourself. It's like you just always have to be, it's just like constant monitoring.
Totally. And yeah, you're right. That monitoring is so joy sucking because it just keeps you from being in the moment. And, you know, one ingredient in joy, I think, is being in the moment, being present, being able to respond to what's going on around you and sort of laugh at the weird connections that are happening. Like I have a piece in my book about this hardest time you've ever laughed, this concept from another podcast actually called You Made It Weird with Pete Holmes, which I don't recommend across the board, but I really like for some reasons. It's very like, he's a comedian, he's awesome, but he's like very caught up in the wellness diet. So like caveat for anyone listening, don't go and just Google that right now because it's probably going to have some really triggering stuff in it. But he does this thing that I think is really cool where he asks people to share the time they laugh the hardest in their life. And oftentimes it's something that's just like so ridiculous and random. Like you had to be there. It doesn't really make a lot of sense when the person's telling it. It's just like a moment, you know, it's a little moment that just something was somehow so funny that the person like lost it. And when I think about moments like that for myself too, I'm like that kind of unbridled laughter and joy. It doesn't come from someone necessarily telling a joke or like being in a scenario that's supposed to be funny. It's from those little unexpected things that come up where someone just like says something that catches you off guard. I think being able to be in the moment is really important for that, for being able to receive and connect in those ways.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Being able to be in the moment and being able to be in your body. So what was one of your moments of just like totally cracking up?
The one that, there's a bunch of them that I can't even remember the context at all, where it's just like losing it in math class in high school for some unknown reason or, you know. But the one that I can remember the context of was a few years ago, my husband and I were at the beach and we like walked around a sand dune sort of like around the corner and there was this giant seagull just sitting there. And my husband goes, "Hello, bird." And like, we like talk in that accent to our cat sometimes because we have this whole thing about how he's like a Russian spy. And so just like him like making that connection of like the way we talk to our cat and this bird being there, it was totally unexpected. I think we were talking about something else, but it just caught me completely off guard. And it, yeah, I just lost it. And so, and I, you know, that it sort of made me realize like that type of moment is, especially because I was at the beach, right, in that context. And like in years past in my disordered eating days, and yeah, certainly probably in adolescence too, like being at the beach would have been so fraught with like, how am I looking? Is my stomach okay? Is this okay? Is that okay? Can I be seen in a bathing suit? You know, all of these thoughts, right? And so I feel like you miss out on little opportunities like that, like that little moment could have just totally passed me by because I could have been in a mental loop of like, oh my God, gotta like move my body in a certain way or hide this part so he doesn't see it or so all this stuff that just clouds out those little moments.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that when we're so self-conscious or self-occupied or for people who are trauma survivors, just the amount of, you know, just trying to keep yourself safe and not being able to let your guard down, how much that really takes away from being able to be open to the experience and experience joy. And I feel like so much of the work I do with people as a psychologist is helping them open up to joy, to kind of infuse, even in the work we do together, infusing joy into our sessions.
That's interesting. What does that look like?
I think in some ways, it can come up naturally because, as you said, it's like these unscripted, you know, joy moments that just happens. And so being open to it, kind of setting the foundation. So part of the foundation is setting a foundation of safety and of trust and respect so people can be open to it, you know, where people know that they can be safe. I mean, definitely, and especially when I run groups, there can be people kind of playing off of each other or just in individual therapy, just playing off of, you know, me and the person that I'm with. So that's a good question. I don't even know exactly how it happens. I just know it is an important part of the work that I do.
Yeah. And that goes back to what I was saying too about those hardest time you laughed moments where it's like, it doesn't really make any sense. It's hard to even think of the context or like what exactly is said, but you kind of just know it when you feel it and it just comes upon you. You stumble into it.
Yeah.
So I'm curious about, I want to hear your hardest time you've laughed story, but I also want to hear how you got from that place of being caught up in diet culture and adolescence to who you are now and the work that you do now. So if there's any moment of joy that maybe you were able to recapture also from doing that work.
Gosh, I feel like there are so many different moments of joy. One moment of joy that comes to mind that isn't like a totally like laughing kind of moment, but just a moment where I was just in my body and I could really feel it. Was one of the first times I went away with my husband and we went to Carmel and we walked along the beach and we just had just a really wonderful day together. And then I was taking a bath just by myself and I put a washcloth on my chest and I just realized, oh my God, I am just so happy. Like this is one of the happiest moments of my life right now.
And yeah, that sort of relaxed, like safe feeling, it sounds like was probably part of the context of that too.
Yeah. And I mean, for me, I think it was really hard. One, you know, it took a long time and I went through a lot. I had a lot of therapy. And, you know, as a psychologist, I really believe in therapy and I think it was so helpful for me. And my initial adult life was pretty difficult and I made lots and lots of mistakes and kind of like fucked up a lot of things. And it took a long time to get to a point where I felt good about where I was and about who I was and was able to really be in a good relationship with a really good person. So I think that was a moment where it was all kind of coming together.
I very much identify with that, feeling like it's hard won to feel good and to be in a good relationship with a good person. I also had many bad relationships in the past and, you know, feel like I had to go through a lot of therapy and a lot of self-reflection and a lot of, you know, time off of dating and stuff to get to the point where I could actually choose someone and be with someone who is emotionally whole or emotionally giving and warm and kind and just good for me.
Yeah, good for you.
Thanks. Good for you too. Yeah. I'm glad we got to this point. I mean, it takes a lot. And I acknowledge the privilege in that too, because therapy is such a privilege for a lot of people. I feel like it's not always affordable or to find the right therapist. Even if you have therapy covered by insurance, it can be a real slog to try to find the right therapist and someone who's a good fit and helpful for you and all of that. And then I think also just having the time and the ability to like the resilience, I guess, to get back out there and, you know, have gone through trauma, but be able to have the tools and the resources to continue going forward, even with that trauma history.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, for a lot of people, not just to find a therapist and somebody who, you know, they can afford who's in their network, but a therapist who understands health at every size or who isn't promoting diet culture and body oppression is hard to find.
So hard. Yeah, I feel like I'm glad that now we have such a great network of health at every size therapists to recommend. And I have like a list that I made of people who've been on the podcast who are therapists working in this field or dietitians working in this field or doctors. But I feel like when people just sort of stumble into it on their own or try to find a therapist through their insurance network, it's such a roll of the dice and often ends up in, especially for people in larger bodies too, often ends up in, you know, a situation where a therapist will re-traumatize the person by recommending like Weight Watchers or Overeaters Anonymous with a particularly strict food plan because there are certain OA groups I've heard that are better, but in general, I think it's a really problematic thing to recommend. And so therapists will just like recommend these things that are intended to be helpful, but actually exacerbate weight stigma by saying, you're right, the problem is you, and here's how to fix it.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Yeah, absolutely. So I did a continuing education workshop. I teach at a graduate school for psychologists, for people who are getting their doctorate. And I gave a continuing ed workshop on fat stigma and health at every size. Mm. And so I was so happy to be able to do that. And it went really well. And so I'm going to be able to, you know, do it again and hopefully do it many, many times to be able to start spreading that message out.
It's so important and so necessary in training for therapists and for all healthcare professionals, I think, to like get that somewhere in your training. But I think especially for therapists in some ways, because the therapeutic relationship is so deep. And I've seen people who had such a great connection with their therapist and their therapist had gotten them through so much and been a beautiful, valuable person to connect with over stuff like trauma recovery or, you know, whatever life stuff they had been doing. But then when it came to anything to do with weight and food, the disconnect was so great that they had to walk away from that relationship. They had to walk away from that therapist. That really breaks my heart because I feel like finding that kind of therapeutic connection and relationship is such a valuable thing and such a hard won thing for so many people. And then to have it be, you know, not possible to kind of get through that impasse with a person, with a therapist, it speaks to, I think, the therapist's lack of education and training about health at every size and about weight stigma and all the stuff, right?
Yeah. I'm really happy that it's getting more well known and just that there's so much more recognition of health at every size. And, you know, the idea that, I mean, something I've heard you say on the podcast frequently is you can't tell anything about someone's health or their health behaviors by looking at their body or by their weight or body size. And you really also can't make any assumptions about someone's emotional health or well-being by looking at their body. By, you know, so it's, I think there can be almost like, you know, oh, well, you know, if somebody's in a larger body, blaming them and telling them that they should change. Or this assumption like, oh, this is a person who's had all this trauma and, you know, it's the trauma that's caused. And I mean, the reality is that weight falls along a bell-shaped curve, just like every other measurable human characteristic. And so, you know, most people are kind of somewhere in that middle area. And then there's going to be the group of people who are, a standard deviation more or less. And even if we all were raised on the Garden of Eden and had the exact perfect amount of food, the optimal amount of exercise, there would still be people who would be very, very fat and some people who are very, very skinny. That's just our normal, beautiful, human, sexy variation that we all come in. And so not making assumptions about someone's emotional or psychological health based on their body.
And I think that's a really interesting aspect of psychotherapy and the sort of historical ideas about body size that are now meeting up with the modern health at every size, understanding of body size. Cause like, I think I spoke with Isabel Fox and Duke about this. Maybe I want to say, like, I've talked about it on the podcast before and I can't remember exactly who it was, but I think it was her. Cause we were talking about Susie Orbach's book, Fat is a Feminist Issue, and like how influential that narrative was, which, you know, at the time when it was written, we didn't have the health at every size science and research showing that weight loss isn't effective and that diets really don't work in the long run for 95 to 98% of people and that body diversity is natural and beautiful and should be celebrated and all the stuff, right? It's like that book painted weight gain as a form, as like a reaction to trauma and a form of protection. And I feel like that narrative got pushed out into the field of psychology so widely that it created so much stigma. It created this notion, this false notion, like you said, of like, if someone's in a larger body, then clearly it's because of trauma. And like the corollary, which I think is also in Susie Orbach's book, that's like, if you heal the trauma, your body size will quote unquote naturally go down, right? You'll just release the weight, quote unquote, is like a term that I see a lot of people with this philosophy using. And the problem with that is just, it's just not borne out by science on how bodies work. And it also just really stigmatizes bodies for their natural inherent diversity. You really can't tell, like you said, about anything that someone's gone through by looking at them. People have trauma in all size bodies. People have relatively non-traumatic backgrounds in all size bodies. And I mean, of course, someone in a larger body in this culture is probably going to face a lot of trauma because of the stigma that's heaped on them in this culture for the size and shape of their body. But it doesn't mean that the trauma caused them to be in a larger body.
Yeah, absolutely. I absolutely agree with that.
And it's just so frustrating that that narrative is still out there now in pop psychology where it's, you know, just sort of taken as a given rather than seeing that, yeah, we live in a culture that really traumatizes people in larger bodies. And we live in a culture that really doesn't do a good job of helping people process trauma in general. And so a lot of people are walking around really traumatized, but that doesn't mean that the weight is some sort of like, you know, that you can unlock the mysteries of weight loss by healing from trauma.
Yeah. Well, and I strongly believe that the experience of having an eating disorder is really traumatic. Just not getting enough food and blaming yourself for diets not working, or, I mean, just restrictive eating is traumatizing.
That's so important and so needs to be said, because I think people think of it as their own fault, right? We were talking a little bit off mic about this, about like the ways that people are inculcated in diet culture to think that everything is everything to do with their quote unquote failure to control their eating is them and their responsibility, instead of seeing it as a part of what diet culture does to us, what deprivation does to us. And that self-blame, I think, is so toxic.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I'll have people come to me and they'll say, oh, I know diets work because, you know, I've lost X number of pounds X number of times. And it's like when you take those steps back and look at the big picture, it's saying, okay, wait a minute. It might quote unquote work for the short term, but then our bodies, they don't want us to starve. And so there's all of these mechanisms that come into place that are like, no, this is not, you know, our body's not going to let us stay in this starving state. And so when people are struggling, they'll have this idea of like, when I'm being good, and then when they're being bad, but it's the whole cycle and stepping back and seeing the whole cycle.
Right. Yeah. And diet culture has such an investment in not letting us see the whole cycle, right? And letting us just see, oh, here's where the diet worked. And then here's where you were bad. And talk about robbing people of happiness and joy, right? Making them feel like it's their fault and that their failures is a great way for diet culture to make us feel like shit and then feel like the solution to feeling like shit is going to be dieting more and losing weight so that we get out of this terrible feeling, so that we escape this self-stigma and oftentimes external stigma too.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So I have this great example of how food restriction, how dieting affects us with my dogs. So I don't know if this will be like a little aside or not, but I have two dogs, and my older dog, when she was about 12, and her name's Eleanor, we decided we would get a puppy to help keep her like spry and running around and stuff like that. So we got Rigby. So we have Eleanor and Rigby. And it was a perfect plan that Rigby and Eleanor race around and they have so much fun together. But when we just had Eleanor, we would feed her and one of us in the family would feed her. And basically like, you know, she'd kind of let the food sit in her bowl all day and she'd eat when she was hungry and then leave the rest. And, you know, she didn't have any diet culture. She didn't have any issues. And then when we got Rigby, he started eating her food. So, you know, we'd feed them both and then the puppy would go and eat her food. And so for some period of time, Eleanor was not getting enough food. She was, you know, on a restrictive diet basically. And so she started getting mad. She's the dominant dog. And so we'd feed them and then Eleanor would, you know, just keep Rig away from her food. And she started immediately eating all of her food and all of his food. And so she went from like feeling like, oh, she could just kind of eat throughout the day when she was hungry. But then this restriction, her way of recovering from it was to totally disconnect from how hungry she was and not just eat her food or what she needed, but eating all the possible food. And so if that happens to dogs, like that happens to us.
Yes. Oh my God, that's such a clear example of this. And I feel like it also speaks to, like we were talking a bit off mic about the Minnesota starvation experiment.
Yes.
And how, you know, it's very clear in that too, because the people who were selected as participants in that study were like conscientious objectors to World War II who were selected basically for their quote unquote mental, you know, fitness or well-being. Like they were kind of like the paragons of mental health of all the people that the researchers screened going in very well adjusted, very happy, or, you know, just sort of even keel. And then the restriction started, the quote unquote semi-starvation, which is like nothing semi about it. You know, it was starvation.
Although semi compared to the diets that women, especially women, are encouraged to go on now, like
right.
Liquids or I don't know, like the supervised, medically supervised, or even Weight Watchers. I mean, the Minnesota experiment, I think they got calories a day, which was way too little for them, but more than what women get when they're dieting. So sorry to interrupt you. But
no, so true. Like it's a very generous diet today that they would give people that. And when you see them go on this quote unquote semi-starvation diet, the effects on their mental health are so profound, physical health too, like all of it, right? But especially I think the mental well-being part is just a very stark contrast. Like people end up hoarding food and binging and having all these behaviors, but also just like kind of going off the rails mentally. One guy had like a psychotic break, right? And ended up in the hospital. And
he tried to chop his fingers off to get out of it.
Yeah. Horrifying.
They became depressed and anxious and they didn't want to socialize. They isolated. They lost their sex drive. They didn't want to have conjugal visits with, I mean, they were all assumed to be heterosexual, but they had, you know, some of them had girlfriends that they were meeting with and they decided they didn't want to do that anymore. They were also hoarding gum and coffee. There's some, I forgot the exact number, but it was like they had to limit them to like cups of coffee a day or you know, something insane like that.
That's wild.
Yeah, these guys became totally miserable, but they knew who to blame. You know, they blame the experimenters and they were like, oh, you know, fuck this experiment. This sucks. Versus when people go on diets and they blame themselves.
So true.
So that totally just steals any possibility of having joy. It's, you know, it just completely shuts you down, which makes sense because if your body doesn't have any fuel to squander, you know, then it wants you to be as shut down as possible.
Yeah, that's so interesting too to think about because, you know, there's all these ways that your body physiologically shuts down when it doesn't have enough fuel coming in, right? Like that your body temperature goes down, your hair and your nails get dry, your reproductive system shuts down, you know, all of that stuff. But also at the emotional level too, like it's too energy taxing to like be happy and have fun or to not feel like depression seems like kind of a turning down of the thermostat too.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the mental health effects, I feel like we see that so starkly in this experiment or in like the situation with your dogs, right? Mental and behavioral effects. But like when you talk to people in therapy and sort of like hear from them what their experience is with dieting, what is the flavor of the self-blame? Like how do people frame it to themselves, how they're feeling?
One thing is that for the people who started restricting their eating at a really young age, their idea of themselves is that they're anxious and depressed. And so they don't link it to the fact that they've been restricting their eating and what I tend to see over the life cycle is, this is a little bit of an aside, is that it's the same person who maybe around 11, 12, 13, they start to restrict their eating and they might be diagnosed with anorexia. And then that same person, as they get a little older into adolescence and they start experimenting with drugs and alcohol and sex, and they often start binging and purging then. And then as they become adults, they might not be purging anymore or as much. And sometimes they even have gone into recovery for drug and alcohol use and they're binging. So it's the same person and there's the same underlying stuff going on, but the eating disorder looks different through the person's life cycle. But that person will often, whenever it is that I meet them, and I've been working with eating disorders for about 20 years. So sometimes I see the same person at different points in their life, or I've been seeing them for a long time, but they will often think of themselves as like, oh, I'm just a depressed and anxious person. And if they start to change their eating, when they start to listen to their body more and eat more when they're hungry and start to let themselves feel satisfied, all of a sudden there can be this revolution where they're like, oh, wait a minute. Like, I'm not depressed. I'm not anxious. Like, I want to do things. Like, oh, and they can feel this sense of happiness and joyfulness that they haven't felt since, you know, pre-adolescence, since maybe before they started to restrict their eating.
So fascinating, because it's really makes it so clear the mind-body connection, right? And the way that like adequate nourishment, having enough food and feeling safe and secure with food affects your mental well-being too in ways that you don't even see. And again, we have like diet culture has such an investment in not letting us see that I think it gets buried for us, that connection.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think diet culture and eating disorders is so sneaky. You know, and so it finds all of these ways to, you know, it's like an abusive relationship where it kind of seduces you. It like entices you in with kind of compliments about like how like great your life will be or how great you'll look. And then it just like slams you with insults.
That's interesting. It does have that sort of two-faced aspect to it.
Yeah.
And like when all the promises it made don't come true, rather than blaming it, it gets you to blame yourself. It like chips away at your self-esteem so that you'll feel like you're the problem, you're the failure.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And it's like, you just didn't do what I said. You just didn't do enough. Or that, you know, for people who, if their weight keeps dropping, there's kind of this like, okay, more pounds. You know, like, okay, I don't have, you know, all the happiness and love and like all those things I want, more pounds. Like you just keep weighing less. And, you know, it's not there. Like you're not going to get it from that.
Right. It's never enough. Whatever number of pounds you lose is never enough to give you all the things, all the false promises, basically, because they're false promises that can't actually be delivered on. And so doesn't matter how much weight you lose, it's never going to be enough to deliver on those things.
Yeah. And it's stealing all of your other sources of joy and happiness. And so eating disorders are isolating you from people because other people are going to notice if you're not eating, or, you know, social events are around eating, or you're just feeling too exhausted to eat, or you have to go out and go running instead. You know, at some point you're not able to concentrate as well or do as well in school or at work, or it's driving you to such perfectionism that It's like the slave driver in all these other ways. So the things in life that really would be joyful are being robbed from you.
Right. Any source of relaxation or connection is getting taken away. And I feel like too, when you mentioned like the isolation from people in your life, I see that a lot too, and definitely felt it for myself when I was struggling, like this idea that, you know, if someone calls you out, then you have to choose between your eating disorder and them, basically. And it, you know, usually, like, I think oftentimes when people are really in it, whether it's a diagnosed eating disorder, disordered eating, and chronic dieting, like, it has the same effect, I think, where people end up protecting the behavior, protecting the disordered eating at the expense of the relationship oftentimes.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And, you know, often, like, people will ask me in terms of their family and friends, you know, if they have a friend or a family member who they love who's struggling, and they'll be like, you know, I'm trying to get them to eat, or, you know, I'm trying to get them to get help, or what should I do? And what I often recommend is, what I say is, you can never really be, you shouldn't even try to be the therapist for someone that you love, for a friend or a family member. And it's just important to stay connected, because any connection is anti-eating disorder. Going to a movie with somebody is anti-eating disorder. You know, staying in someone's life is a loving presence. And so, I mean, once maybe you've said once to them that you're really worried, after that, to drop it and just stay connected. And then hopefully maybe there'll be those opportunities of having some, you know, experiencing some joy with that person, and that person remembering that there is a world, that there's life outside of their eating disorder.
Yeah, because that's kind of a lifeline, right? That connection to the world outside. You need to be able to see that life is possible, happiness, connection, joy, like presence is possible outside of the eating disorder, so that when you start the process of recovery, you have that hope and that sort of like guiding force in the distance to look to. And it's not just like, it's the eating disorder or nothing. I'm just going to, you know, fall out into this abyss of nothingness if I let go of my eating disorder.
Yeah. Yeah. Which is very much like if there's somebody you love who's in an abusive relationship, that just because abusive relationships intentionally isolate you.
And so, yeah, giving them a sense that they're not isolated and they actually do have people to connect with outside of this abusive partner is really important.
Yeah. But I think something that you said, backing up, I don't even remember how long ago you said about, oh, you're talking about junior high and about being surrounded with people who are feeling and thinking the same way. And so when it comes to diet culture and eating disorders, and certainly it was this way when I was growing up, that it seemed like all of my friends, I mean, it wasn't that all of my friends had grown up and gotten teased and were fat kids. That was kind of unique, I think, to me, but they all were dieting and all were believing in diet culture. And we all were seeing it in magazines and, you know, reading about it and seeing the TV commercials, and all of our moms were going to whatever, you know, diet place and, you know, stuff like that. So it did seem like it was everywhere.
Totally. Yeah. And I think at that age too, it's sort of like, I don't know, adolescence seems like a time when you get more tuned into what's happening in the world around you. You know, it's like you're coming mm-hmm. into your own, and that's what's happening in the world around you. And that's like the world of adults that you feel like you're being indoctrinated into. Then it's only natural to sort of gravitate towards that stuff and be like, well, I guess this is what it means to be like a grown up or a teenager, like someone with, you know, agency or whatever, is to go on a diet. And this is what it is.
Yeah. To be an adult woman.
Oh, especially an adult woman. Yeah. And I mean, obviously that's complicated for people of other genders too, because there's the whole like not feeling, you know, having body or gender dysphoria in addition to body dysmorphia, right? And feeling like there's, you know, you don't want to be in the body that you're in is another layer to it that can happen, especially in adolescence.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
And then also the sort of layer of, you know, external discrimination for your gender or for your body size, right? Like there's the, I feel like you know, the sort of bullying and teasing that kids go through is like a different, it's all traumatic no matter what. But I think there's like a new flavor of it that comes along when you're an adolescent or young adult, where it sort of starts to feel like, and in some ways actually is a determinant of your future, in the sense of feeling like you're not going to be able to find a partner, or feeling like you're not going to be able to get a job. And in fact, research shows that people are less likely to get hired if they're in larger bodies because of this pervasive discrimination we have in our culture. It starts to feel more, I guess there's like a reality to it that sets in.
I have actually very strong opinions about the whole getting a partner thing, because, you know, I've been working with people with eating disorders for over 20 years, and I've seen the whole gamut of, you know, all different types of people of all different shapes and sizes. And, you know, I'm privy to people talk about their relationships. And the best relationships that I have seen are often the relationships of people in larger bodies. And some of the worst relationships I've seen are people who are in a like cultural sense, check all the boxes in terms of, you know, how they look. And even people who are like models and, you know, actresses and professional cheerleaders and, you know, like stuff like that, that they have some of the worst relationships that I've seen. And I think it has to do with objectification. If a relationship is based on object value, based on like being a good object, then the relationship is on pretty shaky ground. And relationships that are based on, I mean, certainly attraction, but full circle attraction, you know, for who this person truly is, and mutual respect and caring. And it's when it's not about like, oh, this is like an object I can show off, that those are really the happiest and the long lasting relationships that I see. So in some ways it's a good like sorting mechanism, mm-hmm. you know, to like not, you know, like looking in this way that our culture says, oh, you have to look this way to get love. It's like actually not looking that way might actually be a little bit more helpful.
That's so interesting. And I spoke with Krista Niles. I don't know if you know her, but she's like a relationship therapist and dating coach. And she's actually also based in the Bay Area. Spoke with her for the podcast a few months back. And she was saying a similar thing, that in her experience, because she's fat and she had lots of ups and downs with dating and stuff, but has recognized in her experience and that of her clients that being fat or having an identity that's a little outside the sort of object value, you know, the like cultural ideal that makes you more likely to be objectified, having an identity outside of that is actually a really powerful sorting mechanism for finding someone who's not a jerk. And that in her view, like, you know, finding like she was like, you know, people who match up with the cultural ideal for beauty often, especially women that she was working with, often attract narcissists, that there's, you know, a much greater likelihood of being sort of preyed upon by narcissists because you have that object value. So I think that's really interesting that the struggles are different when you have different identities. And that doesn't mean that it's not still a struggle, that people don't still feel like they can't find a partner when they're in a larger body, or maybe have traumatic experiences where someone did body shame them in an intimate relationship. And that is horrible. But also that, yeah, it's actually possible. And there's so much hope for finding a relationship that's not like that in the body that you have now without having to lose any weight.
Yeah. I think in that podcast, wasn't it also something like there was a statistic switch where I think how you thought it was maybe that only 20% of men are attracted to like women in larger bodies, but she said, oh no, it was 20% aren't, and 80% had said like they'd be cool with it, or, you know, sure, or yes, so, you know, something like that.
Yeah, and she said that she even had, because I had gotten that statistic from her before, and she said she was like misreading the research because it was like basically 20% strongly prefer, I think it was, like people in larger bodies, and then 20% strongly prefer people in smaller bodies and the rest kind of don't care, or the rest are like open to anything. And so, yeah, you know, when you take the 20% that strongly prefer plus the 60% that are open to anything, it's a much bigger pool of people than you might think that are open. And I think this was like specifically in hetero cis men. So it was like, it's a larger percentage of cis hetero men than you might think are open to dating a woman in a larger body. And of course, that's complicated by so many factors too. Like there's racism that can be at play and sizism even within people who accept, they'll accept dating a plus size person to a point or whatever. But I think it is still overall, I think, a much more hopeful picture than we're led to believe in diet culture and in society, because we're led to believe that like everyone is in that like heinous 20% that's like, no, I will only date, you know, a supermodel. And like those people suck, but also not everyone is like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's kind of cool to realize that. And I will say too, like when I was trying my hardest, you know, I fit the cultural norm, I think, in a lot of ways anyway, but when I was really trying to like shape myself into that mold and, you know, lose weight and be like the thinnest I could possibly be and, you know, pluck my eyebrows and dye my hair and all of the stuff. Not that those things, you know, can't also be parts of like self-expression, but for me, they were very much parts of self-abnegation. When I was doing all that stuff to try to fit into that cultural norm, I had the worst relationships I've had in my life. Like I've never been more emotionally abused and even physically abused in a couple of instances than when I was in that place. And I think it, you know, speaks to the self-image that puts you in a place of feeling like you need to change yourself and need to do all this stuff to fit the cultural ideal and be worthy is the same sort of mindset that tells you like you only deserve this or you have to accept what you can get or it's hard out there. So like be grateful for what you have.
Yeah. Oh, I'm so sorry.
Thank you. Thank you. I mean, I'm like 5.5, 6 years out from it now. So I feel like I'm finally able to like talk about it in a way that's not triggering and to feel like I actually just had this experience probably 6 or 8 months ago of, so my husband is wonderful and it's the first like really healthy relationship that I've had. I've had a few on and off, but the first one that I've had that I was really invested in, because my pattern historically was always to be like really gravitate towards the jerks. And then the guys who treated me well, I was always ambivalent about. And I was the one kind of questioning the relationship. This is the first relationship where I'm like, I'm all in. I love this person and he loves me and he's good. Like, it's weird that that all lines up, you know?
That's it's not weird.
It's not weird. I felt weird at first, for sure. It's the result of like years of therapy that allow me to have those things line up, you know. But still, I think in this relationship, I've had this feeling in the back of my mind that like it could all go away at any moment and manifest in a lot of like worries when he's away. That like, oh my God, is he going to get in a car accident or like get stuck somewhere and, or, you know, is he going to just die on me? And like, I'm going to be widowed, you know, like the sort of way that my brain just kind of manifests that anxiety, you know? But I think 6 or 8 months ago was the first time I was sort of like, what if I just stopped thinking like that and just let myself be happy for where we are and just trust that we're going to be together. Just allow myself to entertain the possibility that we will like die together in each other's arms when we're 100. What would that feel like, you know? And so I can go into that sometimes and it's just like such a deeper feeling of safety. And then sometimes I still have those moments where I'm like, oh my God, is he okay? It's raining and he's driving or whatever. And I feel like I also have come a long way in the sense of like, I don't text him a million times when that happens and like externalize that fear. But I know it's there.
Yeah. Oh, I would have dreams that I cheated on my husband and then I would wake up and just be so relieved. Just like, oh, thank God I didn't ruin it. Like I haven't destroyed it. That was just a dream. Thank God.
Oh, I've had that too, actually, those dreams. It's funny.
We have so much like trust and openness. And in the dream, I would be like, okay, either I can't tell him and then there's this wall between us and that's going to ruin everything. Or I tell him and then he'll know and that will ruin everything. And then waking up and being like, oh, it was a dream. Thank God.
Totally. Oh, my God. All the ways that our brains are like, you're not safe, right? Just try to like bring back in that anxiety.
I think for me, and I think this goes way back to just how I felt as a kid, I think, I've had this incredible sense of shame and having to hide certain things about myself. And before I got into the relationship with my husband, I tried to do a lot of soul searching about what I had done wrong in previous relationships. And I mean, the easiest thing in a relationship is to be like, oh, it was the other person. Like, I just chose wrong. And, you know, that can be true sometimes, or, you know, but to really think about what I was doing and what I needed to do differently. And for me, it was hiding. It was hiding parts of myself. And that I decided that what I needed to do was just to really like anything that I think, oh God, I'm really ashamed of this. I better not tell Conrad. That means, oh, I better tell Conrad. and usually it's like something, it doesn't have anything to do with us even. It's just some like stupid little shameful thing about me that I, you know, but just in telling him these things, then I'm allowing myself to be fully loved, you know, rather than hiding, rather than it being like the kind of like the Instagram edited version of me, you know, the like real, not perfect in every way vision of me.
Right. Because trying to be loved for that is like a conditional love, or it feels like a conditional love, right? It feels like if I just keep all this stuff secret, then he'll love me. But if he ever knew, then it'd be over. It's that, I feel like that's the belief, right? And so then it feels like the love is conditional, even though it is unconditional. And if you were to open up about it, you'd be seen and loved and supported and it'd be fine. But there's this sense and this fear that that's not possible.
And I think some of that goes back to diet culture, or diet culture exploits that idea that we're only deserving of love if we have this certain kind of body. And it's actually the certain body that's impossible to have or sustain.
Right. And like the further away from that you are, the more intensely you're made to feel like you don't deserve love.
Mm-hmm.
Like stigmatized and shamed for who you are. It creates that sense of conditionality too. Like I definitely know people I've worked with who got into relationships when they were thin, you know, immediately post weight loss, right? And then inevitably regained the weight. And it was a source of shame and a source of fear that their partner wasn't going to be okay with it, or that their partner wasn't attracted to them anymore. And just like really difficult conversations, having to have those with their partner and with themselves of like, you know, is this relationship really unconditionally loving, or was it conditioned upon how I looked? And in some cases, recognizing, oh, actually, it's so much more deeply unconditional than I ever recognized, you know, and just allowing themselves to go there.
Yeah, hopefully. Yeah. Well, and I think then that like kind of leads to the whole like wedding industry. And I remember your podcast interview with Lindy West and her talking about resisting just this oppressive, you know, like wedding world of how like you're supposed to like lose weight before your wedding. And like what it means to be a bride.
Oh, it's a nightmare. I love her piece. For anyone out there who's like struggling with this, her piece called My Wedding Was Perfect and I Was Fat as Hell the Whole Time. It's just such a great like liberatory fuck you to the wedding industrial complex and how tied up it is with diet culture.
Yeah.
Because this idea of like shrinking yourself for the wedding just literally takes you away from your connection with this other person that is what a wedding is supposed to be about. You know, it's supposed to be celebrating two people coming together and celebrating their love. And in fact, it's, you know, like for so many people, I think it becomes this stressful event and experience where they have to perform for everyone else but themselves and but their partner.
Yeah. And the thing that's so important is you have to look this certain way.
And that's what is required of a bride, and increasingly of grooms too. I mean, I think also like in the gay male community, it's the pressures are really intense. And I've definitely known some gay men who, you know, try to lose weight for their weddings. But even I think cis straight men are feeling that pressure too. But it's, you know, still I think the pressure on brides is the most intense at this point.
Yeah.
I want to hear a little more about how you kind of got to where you are now, like how you broke free from diet culture and the maybe some of the relationship issues too that you struggled with.
Gosh, that's such a big question.
I know, in like 5 minutes now.
Yeah, it's enough. Okay, so where I am now, how I got to where I am now, I started out my career as, I was a lawyer. I went to law school at UCLA, and I knew pretty quickly that I really didn't want to be a lawyer. And the only thing I really liked about it was I would do things like homeless legal aid. I would volunteer places, and I loved working with and connecting with people. And so that made me realize, okay, I need to, you know, just like as fast as possible, stop being a lawyer and go back to school to be a psychologist. And also, you know, when I was a lawyer, it was 1991, 1992. It was during the Anita Hill, Clarence Thomas. And there was also this Kennedy rape trial going on. And I remember how the lawyers would talk about just about women in general and about those things that were in the news. And it was just so, it just felt so awful. It felt so hostile. And so when I went back to school to be a psychologist, I definitely wanted to do something with feminism. And I definitely wanted to work in some way with eating disorders. So I knew that for sure. And my dissertation, you know, all those years back, was on feminism as a determinant, feminism having a protective effect for eating disorders and body image satisfaction.
So awesome.
Yeah. So it was really what I always wanted to work with. And I definitely feel like it's reinforced my own recovery and my own sense of who I want to be in the world. I mean, there's so much privilege in being able to choose the work you do and being lucky enough to do that and being able to choose to do work that really reflects my values. And so over the years that I've been a psychologist, it's felt like kind of like water over rocks in terms of changing me for the better, you know, with my own healing in all of my relationships and including my relationship with my body. When I'm working with people, I have such a sense of like hopefulness for them, and I can really see their strengths. And that's actually helped me even more so see mine and hold that kind of same hopefulness for myself as I've gotten older and gone through my life. And I love what's happening now with the whole health at every size movement and how it's exploded. And I feel like I also get so much inspiration from you and from people in your generation who are doing what you're doing, who are, you know, really creating the social justice component of it and just exploding the health at every size message and also making it fun. So, you know, creating like babe camps and cool, like, you know, Instagram accounts and really amazing YouTube videos that are both really funny and also really powerful. I think one of the first inspirations along those lines was Marilyn Wand's book, Fatso. So F-A-T exclamation point, S-O question mark. And that book was huge for me. I was right when I was starting to teach a class at City College in San Francisco called Psychology of Eating, Food, and Weight. And so I read the book. This was like before I was on the internet. And I called Marilyn up just out of the blue and said, you know, would you come guest lecture in my class? And she's like, yes. And she came in every single class I taught every semester for like, I don't know, for like 15 years. She came into every class. Yeah, wow. She was amazing. And people still come up to me and they'll remember the lecture that she gave was so life-changing. And then at that same time, also Linda Bacon was there, also at City College. And when I left City College, Linda took over the class and made it like 1,000 times better, you know, and added all of the social justice stuff from body respect and, you know, just how this whole movement has been building on itself. And in class, Marilyn would, she would say that quote by Gandhi, which is something like, you know, first they ignore you, then they laugh at you, then they fight you, and then you win. And I feel like that's what's happening.
Yes. I totally feel that. I feel like they're fighting us now.
Yes. We've gotten to that point. It's like we're powerful enough that now they're fighting. And especially, you know, the $70 billion diet industry, you know, they don't want diet culture to be challenged.
No, they don't want to go down without a fight. It's a lot of money they stand to lose.
Yeah, absolutely.
But it's really inspiring and just so cool how you've done this work for so long and seen these changes and are part of the shift, and that it is like this momentum building. It really feels like a snowball effect where people have been doing this for long enough and more people coming on board that we are an army, and we're each, to use Kelly Deals's metaphor, she talks about taking your place at the wall, the wall being like cis hetero patriarchy, white supremacy, you know, diet culture, all of it, right? And like we're taking our place at the wall and chipping away. And there's just so many of us now that there really are cracks in the wall. But then the people on the other side of the wall are like, no, you stay out.
Yeah. Wow. I feel like that analogy just speaks to so much about what's going on right now in our world.
Yeah, the wall.
Yeah.
And like the idea of like build the wall is really sort of building back up that wall of racism, that wall of xenophobia, but also sort of in a larger sense, like that wall of just bigotry in general. And then there's those of us on the other side trying to tear it down.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Ugh. I could talk to you forever. This is like such a great conversation, and I hope we can have part two someday and maybe in person.
Oh my gosh, I would love that. I would absolutely love that, both.
Yes. Oh, amazing. Well, tell us where people can find you and learn more about your work.
I have a website. It is drstephaniezone.com. So drstephaniezone.com. And that's really the main place that I am. I'm not like, this is my first public thing. So, I mean, other than teaching, you know, teaching classes and giving continuing ed workshops, stuff like that.
Yeah. And that's all like very public, but in person. This is more internet based. So I feel very honored. Thank you for being the first, doing my podcast as your first internet appearance.
Oh my gosh. Thank you. I am so honored. This is really kind of a dream come true.
Aww, thank you so much. That means a lot.
Well, thank you.
So that's our show. Thanks again so much to Stephanie Zone for joining us on this episode, and thanks to you for listening. This episode was brought to you by my forthcoming book, Anti-Diet: Reclaim Your Time, Money, Well-being, and Happiness Through Intuitive Eating, which is available for pre-order now at christyharrison.com/book. That's christyharrison.com/book. And for only about one more week, 1 week and one day, if you're listening to this on the day it comes out, you can get some awesome exclusive bonuses when you pre-order the book. Just go to christyharrison.com/book for more details. If you've gotten something out of this podcast, please help us reach more people who need to hear the anti-diet message, because who doesn't in diet culture, by sharing this episode and subscribing to the pod on Apple Podcasts or your favorite podcast platform. You can see all the places to subscribe at christyharrison.com/subscribe. That's christyharrison.com/subscribe. You can also leave a nice rating and review for the podcast in your provider of choice, which is another way to help new listeners discover the show and is always so appreciated. If you're looking for some practical tips to help you get started on the anti-diet path, grab my free audio guide, 7 Simple Strategies for Finding Peace and Freedom with Food. Just go to christyharrison.com/strategies to get it. That's christyharrison.com/strategies. To get full show notes from this episode, including all the resources we discussed, plus a full transcript, head over to christyharrison.com/218. That's christyharrison.com/218. And to get the transcript, just scroll down to the bottom of the page and enter your email address. A big thanks, as always, to our editor and sound engineer, Mike Lalonde, our community and content associate, Vinci Chui, and our administrative assistant, Julianne Watasik, for helping me out with all the moving parts that go into producing this show every week. Our album art was photographed by Abby Moore Photography and designed by Meredith Noble, and our theme song was written and performed by Carolyn Pennypacker Riggs. Thanks again for listening, and until next time, stay psyched.